Welcome to Honors Pre-Calculus, section 5.3. Today we're solving trig equations. And our joke of the day, I don't know if any of you have noticed this in the grocery store, but they have a product that is made by dehydrating cranberries. And instead of like dehydrating grapes and calling them raisins, they dehydrate cranberries and they call them craisins. So I've got a bag of craisins, and these, when you pour them out, they make a trig function, so they are triggy craisins instead of trig equations. So I hope you get a good laugh out of that. Our first type of example, it says to solve, and if you look at this, we are trying to find, in 26, we're trying to find an angle so that root 2 times the sine of this angle plus 1 will equal 0. Well, first step we want to do is we want to isolate that trig function so that maybe we can draw some reference triangles based on that trig function. So I'm going to subtract the 1 and divide by root 2. The sine of the angle I want equals a negative 1 over root 2. And I'm going to leave it rationalized like that, or sorry, unrationalized like that, because when it comes to drawing triangles, it was helpful to leave it unrationalized. So where in our four quadrants is sine going to be negative? Well, sine means height, so a negative sine is going to occur down here in quadrants 3 and 4. So I'm going to draw those reference triangles in those quadrants. There's two different places it could happen, so there's two different reference triangles. They both have a y of negative 1 on r of root 2, and we know by filling in the rest that it's a 1, 1, root 2, it's a 45, 45, 90, acting as our reference triangles. So, we always start measuring angles in the positive x-axis, though. The angles we're trying to measure, though, what gets to that first terminal side down in quadrant 3? Well, it's 180, or pi, plus another pi on 4. We know our reference angle inside is a 45 degree pi on 4 radian angle. So my first angle is going to be 5 pi over 4. Well, then I've got my second terminal side, the other angle that could have a sine of negative 1 over root 2. I'm just going to call that theta 2. Still have a reference angle of pi over 4 inside, but outside I'm going all the way around and stopping pi over 4 short of a full 2 pi circle. So my two angles are 5 pi over 4, 7 pi over 4. Now they didn't restrict what my angle could be, so my answer is anything that could lead me, including any coterminal angles that could lead me to the angles produced in those two quadrants. So I need to add, let's see, the period, a full circle will get me back to that first tangent, so I got to add 2 pi some number of times. So what that little plus 2 pi n is telling me is that adding any multiple of 2 pi will also lead me to a sine of negative 1 over root 2. So I'm just going to add that little note, plus 2 pi n, so I have a complete answer. Okay, let's try number 30. Again, we want to isolate the trig function. We've got cotangent squared x minus 1. Let's add 1 and divide by 3. So cotangent squared of x is 1/3. And if I take the square root of both sides, that means the cotangent of x is plus or minus square root of 1 over square root of 3. And to better help me draw the reference triangles, I'm going to use a reciprocal identity. I like to revert to the one of the big three, sine, cosine, or tangent, to help draw the angles. That means my tangent is going to be plus or minus root 3 over 1. Okay, so looking at our four quadrants here, where can tangent be positive or negative? Well, that happens everywhere. So there's going to be a reference triangle drawn in each of our four quadrants, and these are not to scale. Remember, we're just trying to get placement in the correct quadrant. Tangent means y on x, so every height, y, is going to be root 3, either in the positive or negative directions. And x then is 1, so that's going to be a 1 either heading in a positive or negative direction, again, depending on where that triangle is located. Okay, we start measuring all four of these angles from the positive x-axis. The first one leads me to that terminal side in quadrant one, and hopefully we see the 1, root 3, and 2, that 30, 60, 90 right triangle forming. So theta 1, my first angle, well, what's the angle that produces an opposite leg of root 3 inside of 30, 60, 90? It's got to be 60 degrees. That's pi over 3 radians. Theta 2, I move to this angle. Now I'm stopping pi over 3 short of a full pi. That's 2 pi over 3. Here I'm going pi over 3 past. And then our last angle, coming all the way around, now we're pi over 3 short of a full circle. That's 5 pi over 3. So, in each case, again, they haven't limited us to one full circle, so any coterminal angle can also be added. Oops, 2n. And we have that. Now, if you're a person that is checking your work with the answers in the back of the book, something we strongly recommend doing. Sometimes what they'll do in the back of the book is they will simplify this, and they'll say, oh, you got pi over 3 plus 2 pi over 3n or something like that. They will try and combine those together into a couple statements or into one statement if possible. So just realize this is the correct answer, but sometimes they will consolidate their information when they're putting the answers in the back of the book. This next one is a little bit different, and you'll notice it's because we have a pre-function acting on our x. What are we thinking? We're thinking this is 3 times as fast, so that angle, that tangent function, is zipping through our graph 3 times as quickly as it normally would. It's a horizontal compression. Okay, so we're just going to keep that in mind. Here our trig function is isolated almost. We got a square root both sides. So the tangent of 3x equals the square root of 3 plus or minus when we square root both sides. And this is a good opportunity when we have this angle inside this 3x. It's another good case for u substitution. So let's let u equal 3x. And now we'll just solve this equation normally, and it'll give us an opportunity to substitute that 3x back in once we get to the end. So what have I got, really? I've got the tangent of some angle u equaling plus or minus root 3. Okay, well, this looks very similar to the last example we just went through. Where is tangent going to be, positive or negative root 3? We're going to have those reference triangles formed in all four quadrants. Again, y on x is going to be root 3 over 1. We're going to have a radius length of 2 as we rotate those sides around. And again, our reference angle inside is going to be 60 degrees or pi over 3 radians. So here, this first angle, this first u, oh shoot, I just realized that in the last examples I was using thetas instead of x's. They were asking for x's here for the angle. And I was using thetas, so I apologize if there's like a little disconnect. Instead of saying theta 1, theta 2, I should have said x1, x2. I just used an inappropriate variable, that's all. Okay, so my first u value is going to be pi over 3 radians, right? If I measure from the positive x-axis to my first solution in quadrant 1, it's pi over 3 radians that gets me there. U2, 2 pi over 3 to get to that second quadrant solution. Third quadrant solution, u3, that's going to equal, let's see, what is that going to be, 4 pi over 3. And finally, our fourth angle, the one in quadrant 4, going all the way around, that's going to be 5 pi over 3. And in each case, again, they don't specify to keep it within a full circle, so I'm adding 2 pi n. To each answer. But now we got to think, u wasn't what we were solving for. That's a value that we substituted in. Let's find the actual x solutions. So what u1 really means is 3x equals pi over 3 plus 2 pi n. To solve for x, I would need to divide both sides by 3. So that tells me that in this first solution, x equals pi over 9 plus 2 pi n over 3. For the second one, again, if I think of dividing everything by 3, that's how I would solve for x. Now I would have 2 pi over 9 plus 2 pi n over 3. I would have x equals 4 pi over 9 plus 2 pi n over 3 for my third solution. And lastly, x equals 5 pi over 9 plus 2 pi n over 3. Now, why does it make sense that what I'm adding each time, it's not the period of 2 pi that a typical tangent has? Ooh, a typical tangent only has a period of pi. Interesting. But why are we adding our coterminal angles, I should say, divided by 3? Well, it has to deal with what we talked about at the very start, where it's going 3 times as fast, so it's getting through a full cycle in 1/3 the time. So a coterminal angle is not 2 pi away anymore. Sorry about that, I hit the mic. It's not 2 pi away. Now it's 2 pi divided by 3, since it's moving 3 times as quickly. So there's definitely some patterns at play here. That list in green of all of our x values, that is the appropriate set of solutions. But once again, the textbook may condense that into a more concise statement. Just realize, if you did this work, try and make the connection with the back of the book, see how they arrived at what they did. But this is a correct solution. All right, our last set of examples here. Now they tell us to solve for some x that is between 0 and 2 pi. So now we're trying to keep all of our solutions on a single rotation, a single circle's movement through our four quadrants. And these are a little bit more difficult to work with. Obviously, here in number 40, we've got 2 sine squared x plus 2 cosine x. We've got 2 different trig functions. So what we want to do is try and get that down to 1 trig function, if at all possible. That would allow us to factor and come across some solutions that would allow us to graph and find these actual x values we're looking for. I know that sine squared is the same as 1 minus cosine squared. That's a Pythagorean identity. And applying that Pythagorean identity will put everything in terms of cosine. So, little distribution. And I've got a trinomial here, so I'm going to try and get that set equal to 0. I'm going to move everything to the right so that my cosine squared is positive. That'd be 2 cosine squared x. I would subtract 2 from both sides, so those cancel out, plus cosine x equals 0. Now I'm able to factor out a cosine on both sides, so I've got 2 plus 2 cosine x plus 1. This first factor is telling me where is cosine x equal to 0. Second factor is telling me where is 2 cosine x plus 1 equal to 0. And if I solve that, subtract 1, divide by 2, where is cosine x equal to negative 1/2? So let's draw these up. Okay, I'll do the first work in blue here. Where is cosine equal to 0? Well, cosine means left or right movement. There is no left or right movement when we're dealing with those two quadrantal angles that I've emphasized here. First one, of course, would be at pi over 2 radians. The next one, 3 pi over 2 radians. Okay. Next, we'll do this work in green. Where is cosine going to be negative 1 half? Cosine is negative off to the left. So my two reference triangles take up quadrants 2 and 3. And x on r, that's a negative 1 over 2 in each case. I can see that that is a 30, 60, 90 right triangle forming. And once again, inside we've got a reference triangle, x prime, that is pi over 3 radians. That's the angle that's happening inside each of those reference triangles. So what is actual x in this case? The x's from this second factor are going to be 2 pi over 3 radians and also 4 pi over 3 radians. So those two angles combined with the two angles that came out of our first factor, those are the set of all solutions that will work for that expression in number 40. We have four solutions there. Now, another thing that you could do, we talked about earlier, the life hack method. You could, in your calculator, under y1, type in 2 sine squared x, and under y2, type in 2 plus cosine x, and then do calc intersect, maybe set your window to go from an x value of 0 to an x value of 2 pi, and you could see how many intersections occur to kind of verify that there are four solutions to that equation. Calc intersect is a very nice tool to use. And lastly, number 45, we've got cosine x plus sine x tangent x equals 2. And you can see we don't have the same trig functions. We cannot factor anything out yet. Let's just see what we can do with some identities first. So I'll work in black for that. I don't mind this cosine x out front, but it sure would be nice if I could set this up to factor. So let's see, sine x times tangent is sine over cosine. And that whole thing equals 2. Let's get a common denominator, maybe combine these like terms together. So cosine squared over cosine plus sine squared over cosine. Okay, that's cosine squared plus sine squared is 1. I've got 1 over cosine x just using my common denominator that equals 2. Well, if I rearrange this, maybe solve this for cosine x, that leads me to cosine x equals a positive 1 half. All right, so where is cosine going to be positive 1 half this time? Well, it's going to happen in quadrant 1 and quadrant 4. That's where my x value is going to be 1, r value is going to be 2. That x value has to be a positive 1 to produce a positive cosine. And again, our knowledge of special right triangles tells us that a root 3 and a negative root 3, that's a negative sign there, should make up the opposite legs on both those triangles. And again, x prime, the reference angle happening inside each of those, pi over 3 radians. So what are the actual solutions? What gets me to my solution in quadrant 1? Well, pi over 3 radians gets me there, and then all the way around that would be 5 pi over 3 radians to get me to that solution that's in quadrant 4. And again, since I'm limited to one full circle, I don't have to include that plus 2 pi n, don't have to include all the coterminal angles that also produce those solutions. The answers are just pi over 3, 5 pi over 3. So I hope you've taken away a lot from these examples, see how the identities come into play, how they work really nicely with our solving approaches, our factoring abilities that we've got from Algebra 2. It all ties together very, very nicely. That is the end of section 5.3.